Today we shall discuss about the nuclear angular momentum, which is sometimes also called the spin. Now the Stern and Gerlach experiment showed that the electrons had intrinsic spin angular momentum, whose measured value is given by plus minus half h cross. Where h is Planck's constant and h cross is h by 2 pi. Similarly, the experiment showed that the nucleons in the form of neutrons and protons had intrinsic spin angular momentum, whose measured value is also given by plus minus half h cross. Now, many of the nuclear models assume that the nuclear force is central force potential. So the solution of the Schrödinger equation will also lead to orbital angular momentum. That means that the nucleons in the form of neutrons and protons not only had intrinsic spin angular momentum, but they also had intrinsic orbital angular momentum as well. Now the vector sum of the spin angular momentum and the orbital angular momentum gives the nuclear angular momentum, which is also called spin. Now each of the nucleons, that is the neutrons and the protons, quantum mechanically is assigned spin angular momentum s, whose magnitude is given by under root s into s plus 1, where s is called the spin angular quantum number, and its value is half. Now if we assume some sort of or fix some sort of direction, like if we fix a z-axis, which is usually the axis taken along the direction of the magnetic field, then the component of s along the z direction, that is sz, is given by ms h cross, where ms is called magnetic spin quantum number. Now its value is plus minus half. This is in the units of h cross. Now plus half for the direction parallel to z axis, and minus half for direction anti parallel to z axis, or the axis which we have fixed. Now the quantity which is a constant is this sz, and the magnitude of s, that is the vector s, is not a constant. It precesses around the z axis. Like if we have this s, ms can have two values, plus half and minus half. This is sz. So ms is equal to minus half in this case, ms equal to plus half, and the magnitude of s is equal to under root s into s plus 1, and that is equal to half into 3 by 2, that is under root 3 by 2. Now the nucleons are there in the nucleus, and there are many nucleons in the form of the protons and the neutrons. So the total spin angular momentum will be the vector sum of the individual spin angular momentum of the nucleons. That is, in a nucleus having a mass number A, that is A number of nucleons, S is equal to summation SK, where K is from 1 to A, where A is the mass number, and SK is the spin angular momentum of the kth particle. Now, if there are two particles, then the alignment will be either parallel to the one, both of them parallel to the z-axis, or one parallel and one anti-parallel. This will lead to a value of 1, and this will lead to a value of 0. Now we shall go to the orbital angular momentum. As already mentioned, the solution of the Schrödinger equation of the central force potential of the nucleus gives rise to the orbital angular momentum, whose magnitude is given by under root L into L plus 1 H cross, where L is equal to the orbital angular momentum quantum number and which has integral values from 0, 1, 2, 3, like this. Now, having fixed a direction along the z-axis, which is usually again the direction of the magnetic field, then the component of L along that z-axis, Lz, is given by M L H cross, where ML is magnetic orbital quantum number. Now, ML can take value from L to minus L, that is, ML has value L, L minus 1, L minus 2, up to minus L. So, again, this quantity or this vector L is not constant, rather it persists around the z-axis, and the quantity which are constant are Lz and the magnitude of L, which is given by under root L into L plus 1
H cross.
Now, for L equal to 2, we can have, for L equal to 2, ML will have values 2, 1, 0, minus 1, and minus 2. Actually, it will take 2L plus 1 number of values. If L is 2, then ML will have 2L plus 1, that is 5 possible values. 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. And the value of LZ will be any one among these values. So if we draw it, it can be like this. It is the Z axis. And so these are the possible values of ML when L is equal to 2, and the value of magnitude L will be under root L into L plus 1, that is 2 into 2 plus 1, that is under root 6 H cross. The vector L will precess around this Z axis. Now again, the total angular orbital angular momentum L will be the vector sum of the orbital angular momentum of the each nucleon. That is, L is equal to summation LK from K equal to 1 to A, where LK is the orbital angular momentum of the kth particle. Now we shall see the total angular momentum, which is called the nuclear angular momentum or the spin. Now the total angular momentum I is the vector sum of the orbital angular momentum L and the spin angular momentum S, and this is equal to summation LK plus summation SK K from 1 to A. And the magnitude of I is given by under root I into I plus 1 H cross, where I is called the total angular momentum quantum number, which is related to this vector I, and the component along the Z direction IZ is given by MI H cross, where MI is the magnetic total angular momentum quantum number which can take any of 2i plus 1 values from I to minus I, that is I minus 1, I minus 2 to minus I. Now I can have a value L plus half if the Z components of L and S are parallel, and I can have value L minus half if the Z component of L and S are anti-parallel. parallel. Now all these particles will follow the Pauli's exclusion principle, and therefore in one substrate only two neutrons or two protons can be accommodated. Also the value of I will be depending on the mass number. I will be integral multiple of H cross or 0 if A is even and will be half integral multiple of H cross if A is odd. Now how this is so? Now A will be even in two cases: if the neutron is even and the proton is even, also if the neutron is odd and the proton is odd, then A is even. For even A, case 1, if neutrons and protons both are even. Now in this case, or in general, what happens is that the neutrons pair up with the neutrons following the Pauli's exclusion principle, and the protons pair up with the protons, and what happens is that their spin angular momentum as well as the orbital angular momentum cancels each other for a pair of neutrons or a pair of protons. Like this, if there are one neutron and another neutron, then the effect of the spin angular momentum and the orbital angular momentum will be cancelled, and similarly for protons. So if there are even number of neutrons, then the contribution of the orbital angular momentum and the spin angular momentum for each neutron will be cancelled, and similarly for each proton it will be cancelled. So we can think of a nucleus having a core in which there are even number of neutrons which cancels the overall spin and the orbital angular momentum, leading to zero I, and also the protons which are even in number, they also contribute in such a way that they cancel the orbital angular momentum and the spin angular momentum, leading to zero I. Therefore in this case I is zero. Now if case 2, if there are odd neutrons and odd protons, then what will happen that each neutron will pair up with another neutron and each proton will pair up with another proton, and there will be only a neutron and a proton left, and their orbital as well as the spin angular momentum will add up, and which will give a integral multiple of h cross. In this case, there will be a core in which the contributions from the neutrons and the protons will cancel out, and outside the core but inside the nucleus there will be neutron and proton whose angular spin angular momentum and orbital angular momentum will add up, and which will give a integral value of I in h cross, that is integral multiple of h cross. Here I is integral multiple of h cross. Now in the case of this odd A, that is if neutrons and the protons are adding up to odd number of A, now in this case either neutron is even and proton is odd, or proton is even and neutron is odd. In both of the cases, what will happen is that the if suppose neutron is even and proton is odd, then the contribution from the neutron will cancel out and only the contribution from the proton will be there, which will be in half integral of h cross. And similarly, if proton is even, then the contribution of the protons will be cancelled out, and only the contribution from the neutron will be there. And so the core will be as such that the contributions from the suppose in the case of this one, the neutron even and the proton odd, then the core will consist of neutrons and protons, which will have their spin angular momentum and the orbital angular momentum cancelling out, but only proton will remain outside the core, which will contribute to the overall nuclear angular momentum, leading to its value of half integral h cross. Similarly, for the case of if the proton is even and the neutron is odd, there will be a core in which the contribution from the proton will be cancelling out each other, that is zero, and there will be a neutron which is outside the core, which will contribute to the overall nuclear angular momentum or the spin. So this is how the nuclear angular momentum is found. Now classically we can say that when I is L plus S, classically we can say that the L and S precess around their resultant I, and I precess around the Z direction. Let us see how. So this is for I equal to 7/2, where S is half and small l is 3. Here you can see that the resultant of L and S, that is I, here the S precesses around this resultant I, and L also precesses around this resultant I, which precesses along this resultant Z. So this is how the structure looks like. Now we shall see the possible values of Mi for I equal to 3/2. Let us see. For I equal to 3/2, MI will have value 3 by 2 half minus 3 by 2 minus half, giving the z component of I as 3 by 2 h cross, 1 by 2 h cross, minus 3 by 2 h cross, and minus 1 by 2 h cross, which means that for I equal to 3 by 2, there can be 4 possible vectors whose magnitude along the z direction, or the component along the z directions, will be 3 by 2 h cross, 1 by 2 h cross, or minus 1 by 2 h cross, or minus 3 by 2 h cross. Suppose this is the vector I whose component along the z axis is 3 by 2 h cross, which means that this vector precesses around this z axis in a conical section. To understand this, if this is the z axis and this is the vector, then its component along the z axis is 3 by 2 h cross. So this vector precesses around this z axis, whose component along the z axis is always 3 by 2 h cross. Similarly, for this vector, the component along the z axis is 1 by 2 h cross, so it will precess like this. For this vector, the component along the z axis is minus 1 by 2 h cross, so it will precess like this. It will precess like this. And for this vector, the component along the z axis is minus 3 by 2 h cross, so this vector will precess along the z axis in this conical section. So if I is 3 by 2, then the vector I can have this any one of these 4 possible values, having the z component 3 by 2 h cross, or 1 by 2 h cross, minus 1 by 2 h cross, or minus 3 by 2 h cross, and these vectors will precess along the z axis. Now the magnitude of I will be under root 3 by 2, 3 by 2 plus 1, which gives 1.94 h cross, which means that a nucleus will behave as a one entity, and the nuclear angular momentum or spin is given by the vector sum of S and L, that is the spin angular momentum and the orbital angular momentum. So this is all about the nuclear angular momentum or the spin.